Friends of Greg's.
Okay. Yeah, that's... He knows a lot of people.
Yeah.
A lizard?
found it.
That's funny.
I tried making him look super derpy. I hope it worked. His eyes are like super beady and way out there.
All I could think of was Eddie Izzard when you put that name up for some reason.
I mean, it's a pretty dope name.
It's great. It's the best.
The best.
Around.
So Ted Cruz is cheering that a judge blocked an overtime rule that people who make less than $45,000 are allowed to have overtime.
What?
And they're celebrating that they took it down.
It's a good day.
I love Austin. I fucking hate Texas.
Yeah, I think that's the consensus for the most part.
I have
also,
never...
Are we live? Yeah, we're live.
Yeah.
Cool.
I have yet to go to Austin.
Really?
Yeah, never been down to Texas.
Damn. We gotta get you down here. So we have London coming up. December, and we're going to Vegas this weekend. So it's like it's a lot of stuff coming up. But I would like to get you down here if that is possible.
Yeah, definitely.
What day were you looking at? You're looking at the weekend of
what did we say? Like, well, there's the 3rd and 4th. There's the 10th and the 11th. The weekend of the 18th.
Well, the problem is, okay, we're leaving on the 11th to go to Australia.
Right.
So
okay.
It'd have to be the 3rd and 4th.
We could probably do it after.
Or, I mean, do you have New Year's plans?
Ish.
Because we shoot off fireworks at New Year's at my house.
That's awesome.
Like, we have a big party and stuff, so you're more than welcome to come down.
Yeah, I got to figure out when I'm going back to New York. Yeah.
She's not allowed.
Never.
Totally not allowed.
Yeah. Say, how long have you been in Austin?
I'm born and raised in Austin.
Oh,
one
no
of
way.
The few, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, it's pretty badass.
Have you ever
I did the Walt Disney World College program in Orlando.
Oh, that's cool.
I did that twice. So I spent two 6-month stints in Orlando in like 2001 and 2005. And then I moved to Los Angeles for about 6 months around 2008. And I lived out there for about 6 months. I was working on stuff, and then I was offered a job at Rooster Teeth. So I came back.
Nice.
Cool. How did you like Orlando?
I loved Orlando. I worked at Disney. I did two different times I went. The first time I did, I worked at the Great Movie Ride, which, if you've ever been there, it's a slow moving ride at the Disney MGM or Disney's Hollywood Studios.
Yeah.
So I worked that and I loved it. And then after I came back, I did the water tank tour. Or the backlot tour. I did the water tank portion of the backlot tour. Uh-huh. So I got like soak people with water and stuff and do a whole spiel.
That's awesome. Great.
It was fun, man. It was great because it was like I would try to give the same performance. I had my smallest performance I ever did for the backlot tour was 3 people, and the biggest I ever had was like 550.
It was like
I tried to give the exact same performance for everybody. Like I didn't want any. I mean, I always wanted to be like fresh and good. And so I was very. I like working there because. They like when you you kind of like help bring the magic to people, I guess, for lack of a better term.
Yeah.
And to me, in my head, I'm like, these people have spent lots of money to come to Orlando, and like these families, like I want to give them a great time. So it's like I was always on my A game.
That's so awesome. What a cool experience.
I got college credit for working in Walt Disney World.
Yeah, there are worse things, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, right?
All right, I don't know where Katie is.
Playing with the cats.
Yeah, I think I've only been to Houston and San Antonio in Texas. And
okay.
Like, San Antonio is like a glorified Disneyland ride, basically. Like, you walk around and you're like, well, like, this is the Riverwalk, and yeah, that's it.
Yep. And it's like, do you want to go to Hard Rock Cafe or Howl at the Moon?
Yep. Yeah, it's San Antonio's interesting. That's for sure.
Yeah, San Antonio is a dirty city.
Yeah.
Not a huge fan of it, but whatever. Houston's interesting because it's like a giant industrial city, but they have a really cool art scene too. So it's kind of like a weird
mix. Do they?
Yeah.
I wasn't there long enough for that. I know Austin is pretty artsy. It's almost like the Portland of Canada, right?
Portland of Canada? I'm in Texas,
sorry.
Yeah, like
I am out of it today.
People say like we're like a Seattle or a Portland in Texas.
Yeah.
It's lots of arty stuff and but a lot of tech stuff. Like really, it's a real high tech city, really kind of a young city. Because I mean, we have UT here, which is like was the biggest public university in the nation for a while. Hmm. So you know, but then we also have the capital. So we have like this crazy conservative area and then like the super liberal area. It's really weird. And so and like amazing food. Like the food in Austin's great. Good music.
Yeah, is it Tex-Mex that's really good in Austin?
Oh yeah.
Is that yeah.
What people talk about?
Oh yeah. Give me some micheladas. It's good stuff.
That sounds amazing.
Yeah, I forgot. I went down to San Antonio for PAC South. Completely forgot about that.
That's where PAC South is.
Yeah. I totally forgot about that.
It's happening again in January, but like typically when I go there, I'll like walk around for an evening and then I'll call it good. But in January, I remember 2 years ago, it was colder in San Antonio than it was in Seattle in January,
yeah.
Which was strange.
Yeah, I might be going. So I have three things the weekend of PAC South. I'm waiting to hear whether or not I'm going to be brought down there for work. So I might go to PAC South. I'm friends with the guy who works with the ESL. And he had me host the thing at the X Games Austin when they were here.
What?
Yeah, and then the X Games Aspen Winter X Games are happening that same weekend, and he's like, I might have something for you. It's like, that's cool. And also, I've been invited to go to Finland like that previous week, like from Monday until like Friday.
Yeah, dude, go to Finland.
Well, that doesn't pay though. That's the thing.
That's true. That's a good.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
No, it's okay.
Oh, I know. I feel extra bad. I thought you were streaming.
No. I mean, we're broadcasting, but
hi.
Can you sneak over some more?
I can, but I got a pimple face.
Okay.
Oh.
I mean, you can't sneak over. I'll distract them with my awesome hair.
Yeah.
There we go. My peacock hair.
For what it's worth, if I don't show my face, it's a good look. So.
Okay.
It's Emma.
Emma the dog.
Okay, so then I feel extra bad about what I was doing.
What were you doing? Were you Snapchatting?
I was harassing Billy.
What?
Wow.
Did I call it playing with the cats?
I was.
Yeah, she was.
Oh, I'm so good.
You should check out Katie's Snapchat.
I'm going to.
No.
Like, what is that?
Good lord, how many did you do?
That's a lot of Snapchat.
I think there's no. Oh, damn. The other one was my favorite. Like, she's like looking. She's
all right.
I do nothing.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to start up over here. So give us 2 seconds. We'll come back.
Okay.
Oh, man. So I was totally thinking, like, I know that. So, like, Alberta is like the Texas of Canada, is what people say. And, like, I was totally thinking about that. And I just totally got it mixed up as I said it. I was like,
nice.
Yeah, Austin? Yeah. It's the Portland of Canada.
Yeah, the Portland of Canada.
I could dig it, though. I actually don't know what the Portland of Canada is.
God, I hope. I don't know.
Trying to think. I don't know which city that would
Montreal,
be.
Montreal, maybe?
Yeah, maybe.
I have not...
Toronto has a really good art scene.
Does it really?
But, yeah, like, weirdly. It's pretty cool there.
Yeah.
I kind of think it would be Vancouver just because, like, they have a really big art scene as well. They have Emily Carr.
Oh, really?
Pretty big institute.
I haven't gone up there yet, so I need to...
Dude, it's like 2 hours from here. That's okay.
Yeah, eventually.
Point soon.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool. It's pretty sweet.
Everybody raves about it. I just haven't had a chance.
I mean, it's very similar as an experience to Seattle, but I don't know. Like, there, you can go get some drinks and go get some poutine. It's the best.
Nice. I miss poutine.
It's the way to do it.
Or I guess real poutine. I don't know. Canadian poutine.
You can't get any real poutine in Seattle.
Yeah.
Like, any places.
Like, we went to, you know, in New York, we used to go to Montreal all the time because it's 3 hours from the border, right?
Okay, so you've been to Canada at least.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I used to go to Montreal all the time. It's just different side of the country, right?
Yeah. I mean, the culture is pretty different between...
yeah, I can imagine.
West Coast, so...
Yeah. And the poutine is so good.
Oh, man. It's the best. Oh, man. Poutine is in Toronto is the best, says Eel John. No way. I actually haven't had Toronto poutine, but I need to do that.
Whoa, White Knight doesn't know what poutine is. You want to enlighten him?
So it's like fries, gravies. Oh, typical GM has it. That's exactly what it is. And it is phenomenal. It's actually really good drunk food and really bad hangover food. So
yeah, it's so good.
It's the best.
I mean, you know, cheese fries, right? But still.
Well, but like, that's what people like. If you go to an Irish pub, they'll often say, like, here's some poutine. But like,
unmuting us.
I've never been.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hey, we're talking about poutine. Care to chime in?
Nice. There's a place in Austin that makes poutine with waffle fries.
Oh, sounds awesome.
That's kind of sacrilege, but I'll accept
what?
It's a hot dog place. It's a hot dog place called Frank. It's amazing.
Right?
Yeah, it's their website's great. Their website is hotdogscoldbeer.com, which is like the best URL ever. And
that's such a good.
Yeah.
Sound.
I like
what Eric's going.
It's immediately. So anyway, all right. So we told the chat. So anyone in there, you guys, if you have any questions for us, we'll answer them.
We told them to use the hashtag Dungeons and Dragons. Twits and Crits sucks. Divvy the Loot rolls. Jack is the best.
Thank you, Cage.
Katie didn't have any pimples today.
Yay.
Love it.
And I'm trying really hard not to turn my head to the left because our camera isn't being very nice today.
So this guy over here to our left, that's Eric. He's our DM. He's awesome. And below us is Alyssa, who's down there, who is also equally awesome.
And your eyebrows are looking amazing. I don't know if you did something different with them. I mean, they're always great, but like they're very symmetrical.
I was saying her webcam's super sharp.
Right.
I'm not sure what it is, but it's like,
I think she's also bigger. Like, we normally have more people.
But usually it's like kind of pixelated. I don't know why. Like,
is it? Well, I'm also sitting like super close up to my monitor tonight. Usually,
but it's like even the stuff behind you is like really sharp too.
Yeah.
I guess I've never really been able to see the stuff behind you that well.
You're just all around awesome tonight. Congratulations.
Aw, thank you guys. This is my peak. This is as good as it gets.
You win most improved tonight. All right, so again, if anyone in the chat has questions over on my chat or Eric's got a chat up too, I figure we'll answer questions.
Yeah.
I like that Jack was like, I don't remember. I was like, oh my God, look at the camera. And Jack's like, don't worry, I'll distract them with my hair. And I feel like that's exactly what you're doing.
Jack. Peek up. So what do you guys think of D&D so far?
I'm digging it, man. Like, I had only played one session with our D&D group at the office before playing with you guys, and I've had a lot of fun. I think you've also been very good about, like, kind of steering us a little bit. Like, you're like, okay, like, this is how you do it. Like, this is kind of the proper way. And I don't think we've really broken the rules.
Flexible, yeah. I think, has been really helpful and just being very nurturing, I guess. Yeah. We're so new. Like, that time I was like, no, I'm on a horse. I felt so.
I get my horse.
So I don't know if Alyssa. I don't think Alyssa was.
No, she wasn't there yet.
She wasn't there yet.
So it was either the first or second episode.
Thank you, Gage.
I didn't really understand how it. Like, I understood that it was kind of you make it up. It was very improv, improvisational, and we were like leaving the tavern to kind of go on our journey. And I was like, okay, and I get my horse, and now I'm riding my horse, and they're like, where'd you get a horse from? I was like, the stables? Like, you don't just have a horse. It doesn't work like that. It was just really funny.
Yeah, that was really good.
That's amazing.
But
yeah, I mean, you guys have been really, everybody in the group has been awesome. Like, just kind of, you know, we're doing this on a stream, so we have to be more narrative than anything else. You know, we're not using minis. And so everybody's been really cool about kind of just describing what they're doing and coming up with really awesome ideas for, you know, both role playing out scenarios and during combat, too.
Yeah, and the whole idea of, like, you kind of, like, we're not rolling for initiative. It's kind of just like, all right, what makes sense in this situation? Like, what's the order of people? Like, that's a neat way to do it instead of kind of like, oh, here's just, oh, okay, you rolled better, so you got to do something from way in the back. So why I don't get that.
Oh, like, excuse me. Does everyone usually have to, like, roll for who gets to take the turn?
Yeah. So it'd be like, okay, action starts now. Roll for initiative. And then, like, the order of whoever gets highest to lowest roll, that will then determine who's going at what, in what order.
Yeah.
Typically.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Like, actually, with the way that we've been doing it, where you've been describing the scenarios and the combat scenes, like, I've actually adopted that into one of my campaigns just to see how it works, even if you're, you know, in the same room as your friends. And it's actually really interesting. And I think it creates a lot of, I think, unique combat situations that wouldn't necessarily happen if you had your miniatures in front of you.
Yeah. And you know, a lot of us that were around talking, just, it was like one GMing night, we said, okay, how do we make the combats kind of more fun? And because it seems like when we do initiative, you know, everybody rolls for initiative, combat starts, kill everything, instead of being able to find your way out of a combat situation, or to, Katie, what's the word?
Democratical.
Yeah.
To be democratical.
Yeah. To kind of find some way to,
to be more diplomatic.
Yes. Yeah. So you don't really just have to go in and kill everything. Maybe you kill something and then try to talk to the other.
And then threaten.
And kind of create this environment where you're just not, you know, going in and hacking and stabbing all the time. Like, I know for me, one of my favorite kind of encounters was where you first went after the ogre cave, when you went into the next little hallway and you saw the goblins gambling around the table. And then, like, Rookie was running in with coins to start gambling. But then Arcasynth grabbed her leg and, you know, pulled her back, and the coins went flying in.
I thought
that was really cool, and that might not have happened if it was just, oh, here's some guys, roll for initiative
type of thing.
Yeah, I think I'm such a, like, visual person and so imaginative that it's so easy for me to see it all in my head. And I think I haven't played it any other way, but this way is definitely very catered to sort of the way that I enjoy stories. And it's very descriptive, and it's easy for me to get on board with. I think the one thing I had a little bit of trouble with, which is very much kind of giving myself permission to do it, and it's the same thing with acting, honestly, is creating a backstory. And I haven't really, I've been kind of struggling a little bit with kind of creating Hyacinth's backstory.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, well, people don't, that's kind of silly. You shouldn't create a backstory for that. Like, that feels like kind of unusual. And then I've, you know, have friends who play Dungeons and Dragons, and like, yeah, when she was five, this thing happened to her. And you know, it really, like, changed the way that she eats pineapples. And it's like, cool.
Yeah.
It's awesome that you know that. And it's such a great, like, brain exercise too. I mean, to be so thoughtful and imaginative.
Well, White Knight in my chat just said, I want to give an award. Katie had never played D&D a few weeks ago. And a few weeks later, when Jack was away, she was role playing a two-headed character having a fight with herself. So achievement unlocked.
That's pretty rad.
Yeah.
Yeah, I get that. That was actually, like, really fun for me to do, because I just got to interpret your character and just, like, really exacerbate something.
Man, I gotta go watch that one.
So, yeah, it was really funny.
That's great.
Shut up, Hyacinth. No, you shut up.
Ghost Butts in our chat says, given the D&D resurgence, do you or the others take part in any other group plays, like Critical Role, Adventure Zone, anything like that? Like, do you play anything else? We don't, unfortunately.
Mm-mm.
You guys?
I will be next week. We're doing a live D&D game on Monday nights in Seattle, and we're going to be broadcasting that too. So
was that for your not Patreon, Kickstarter?
No, this is just my friend Greg and myself wanted to do a live game. So if you guys want to fly up to Seattle sometime and play some D&D,
Arcusynth might have to make an appearance at some point.
Yes.
That'd be so sweet.
That'd be awesome.
I'll be honest. Katie's not a huge fan of Seattle because she had a bad experience her first time she was here or up there.
Oh, well, it was the first time I had entered the country, like as a planning to stay.
Yeah, yeah.
And we were in the middle of the city in downtown Seattle.
It was during PAX. Was
oh, crazy. Yeah, okay.
That's a difference.
And it was very scary. I kept hearing, like, what I thought were gunshots and sirens. And, like, I noticed that there were no children anywhere. Like, it was just adults everywhere. And I was like, that's so weird that I haven't seen any kids, like, little small children. And to me, that kind of made it feel a little unsafe almost because parents weren't bringing their kids into the city.
Yeah.
And also my wisdom teeth started coming through.
Oh, no.
So my mouth was all swollen and I was just miserable.
Yeah.
I also don't think I had a ticket to PAX, did I?
No,
that's the worst.
Okay. But so she had a rough experience. And like, I love Seattle. Like, I have a lot of fun up there.
Yeah.
And so we've never been when it wasn't PAX.
Right.
So,
yeah.
So you got to come up and hang out.
There we go.
And honestly, if you're in downtown Seattle, don't hang out around 3rd and Pike or Pine. That will ruin your entire experience.
Yeah.
Probably right on like the corner.
Probably. That's actually, yeah.
Actually, Katie, you know what? I don't know if you've gone, but Seattle reminds me of Brisbane a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Like the same, really? Yeah. Like, cause
is it humid?
No, it's clean. Like when I first came to visit Seattle, it was for a PAX, and the only thing I could say was, "Oh my God, this is a clean city." Because I was from New York, so I'm used to New York City, and it's not anywhere as nearly like that. So, but it just reminded me of downtown Brisbane, because when I visited Brisbane, I said the same thing. I'm like, there's no cars, and it reminds me of Manhattan, but clean.
But I always have to remind people to never move here because we don't want more traffic. Also, it rains all the time. You know, it's beautiful, but it rains all the time.
That sounds like an Austin thing. It's like, yeah, Austin's great. Come visit during South By, but go home.
Yeah. So whenever we talk about how beautiful it is, you have to, you know,
yeah.
Put down a counterpoint of how awful the rain is.
Yeah, so bad.
Well,
so bad.
There's a lot of like Native American history there, like Chief Seattle. I guess the namesake of the city. I used to know his speech almost by heart, his big speech to the government. But so yeah, I'd like to learn more about kind of that side of things if I was to visit. And we went to the markets, I think, one day.
That's cool.
Yeah, we went to Pike's place, Pike Market. It's a cool place.
The original Starbucks.
Yeah, went to the first Starbucks. That was exciting.
Did you get a mug there?
No, we didn't go. We didn't go in.
Yeah,
the line was out of control.
But like, bye.
I like the cities on the West Coast. Like, I love like San Francisco is a really cool place. We like visiting there. So I enjoy Seattle. At some point, I'm sure I'll convince Katie to enjoy it as well.
We'll show you around and we'll convince you.
There you go.
Yeah. I feel like it smelled like fish, cold and damp, and everyone was like scary.
So, no. That was just me. That was scary.
Everyone felt like shady. Like they all had a secret they were keeping, and like
we do. None of us like we're all like outwardly friendly to each other. It's called the
Seattle chill.
We're all friendly to each other, but no one really wants to get to know anyone.
Yeah. Hey, Adrian Nightwolf has a question. Yeah, he used our long Dungeons and Dragons Twits and Crits.
Damn, that's awesome.
Rocks, and Katie doesn't have any pimples today. This might be a question specifically for you, Jack, but any tips on running a game as a DM? I've been trying to run one and I can't think of anything. So that would be you guys.
Yeah, I would say that's Eric.
What kind of, but any tips for running a game as a DM? For me, it's just have fun. I've been asked a lot of times, like, how do you, do you have to know all the rules? And you really don't, because you have a table full of players that know a lot of the rules. And everybody's like, oh, I'm so nervous about kind of just getting in front of everybody and playing. And the easiest way to do it is pick up one of the D&D adventures that Wizards puts out, because they're super easy to to get into, and really just have fun is my biggest. Don't worry about screwing up, because everybody screws up, and enjoy the show. And what I, for me, what, where I think a lot of DMs kind of get tripped up in is they try to kill the players. And
which can be okay.
Yeah, but... which can be okay. Player death is fine, but it's not, for me, the main goal of the DM is to help the players facilitate their story, right? You guys, yeah. You guys are telling a story. I'm here to help you do it. I'm not going to make it easy for you, but I'm going to try and make you have this amazing experience and kind of live out a choose your own adventure book, you know?
Cool.
Well, it's got to be challenging too, you know, so I could.
Yeah. And, you know, so like this kind of answers the last question too, where like I just started kind of DMing for the first time only a few months ago. I am in three other games right now. Jesus. And I DM two of them. And so basically I'm doing Curse of Strahd, which is a pre-made game, which is the gothic horror one that was released last year by WotC. And I'm also doing the starter set for a different group who's never played before. And I decided to do the starter set because I thought it was like, you know, it has all of the basic D&D elements that really makes it a classic story. And it also helps you, you know, get into it and realize that, you know, you can put down traps. Here are some role-playing elements to it. But I guess for general, I guess, DM tips, I would firstly kind of figure out what do your players want. You know, do they want more role-playing? Do they want more combat? Do they want a good mix between the two? And then just kind of like on top of what Eric said, it's about all of you guys creating this world, this story together, which I think is really important. And when you're creating that story together, you create memories, you create experiences. Sometimes people's fondest memories together are the memories that they create within D&D, right? So yeah, it's not necessarily about the technicalities. It's not about the heavy, you know, rules. It's about, you know, what are you all going to enjoy doing together?
Cool. Andy Barris in our chat is saying it's the first time he's ever watched, so he's curious if we can go over who our characters are.
Yeah.
So, Katie, would you like to explain who we are when we play?
Yeah, so Jack and I play a two-headed elf. We're wizards, and I play a wood elf, and he plays a high elf, and we were cursed by a, sorcerer. named Bethilda, who was like mad because we kept fighting and she was just kind of like cranky. So she's like, oh, I'm so sick of this. And she just kind of cursed us. And my name is Hyacinth O'Ceridian. And Jack is Archimedes Petilok. I have long, well, I have like copper skin, kind of metallic-y, almost copper skin with lots of freckles and blue eyes and long hair that's never been cut. And Jack has, I think you have short blonde hair, blue eyes, and an earring that your mother gave you.
I do.
That's what it says here.
Cool.
His right ear, earring and right ear given to him by his mother. Oh, you have green eyes and you're very pale.
Oh.
Hyacinth has tan skin bordering on metallic copper, blue eyes, brown hair, almost the same color as her skin, long hair that's never been cut, and a vine headpiece and freckles.
Oh. There you go.
Interesting. Yeah, so
we're like two-headed, but share the same body.
Kind of like Harvey Dent style, where we kind of right down the middle, except we have two necks and two heads.
Yeah. And I have one arm and he has the other.
Cool. All right.
So what are your favorite, what have been your favorite moments so far?
Oh, so, Alyssa, what is your character real quick?
Oh, sorry, my bad.
Rookie is, so she's a half-elf monk. Trying to figure out how to describe her. She has very pale, almost like a blue tinted skin. She's a half moon elf. She has kind of silvery bluish, dark blue hair. And she has purple eyes. I'm trying to think.
She has a spider.
She has a spider. Yeah, Helob. This is Helob. And so I played Rookie in one other streamed session, or not session, but campaign. And that was Out of the Abyss at WotC. And I just figured it was kind of, she was a really fun character to play, and a lot of people enjoyed her. So I thought it'd be fun to translate her over. And she's a cool character. She's fun. She's a
Dramaphobe. And... Sorry.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, like, she's into acrobatics and she hates gems. That was what I was going
to say. Yeah, exactly.
Now, when you play a character like that somewhere else, when you move over to a different campaign, your stats don't carry over?
No.
Okay.
No, I basically just tailored them to where we were, or where your guys' characters were.
Okay.
Just so that it was balanced.
I mean, again, I know very little of D&D, so I didn't know if it was like, okay, here's my character I've been working on, I can take it from campaign to campaign. Mm. But it's kind of, I guess it's like sort of the same groups is where you kind of, like if we were to continue on after we complete this campaign into a new campaign with the same group of people, that character would still be leveled up and we'd start that strong, or do you, okay.
And, well, that's also up to the DM too, right? So if they want the characters to be the same level as when they left off, that's completely fine. What I did was I asked Eric if I could keep some of her backstory elements. So for example, she can still speak Undercommon, even though, broken Undercommon, even though, you know, she wouldn't otherwise if she hadn't gone to the Underdark. So like I took basic elements from Out of the Abyss and added them.
Cool. Okay.
I feel like I should also say that your character is
awesome.
Well, I'm diplomatic, and I kind of like what's best for everyone, and I want to like take people at like I have their best interests at heart, and sort of want to make sure that everyone just see things from everyone's perspective, because I definitely believe that everyone has like equal footing, even if two groups of creatures don't necessarily agree, they both have like the right to exist. So okay, well how do we all live here? Like how do we all deal with this? Like what can we do? And sometimes you can't, you know, debate or have a discussion about that stuff. And that's where Jack just ruthlessly is like, I don't care.
Yeah. I love how your characters contradict each other so often. It's super awesome.
Yeah, it's really cool to see.
But when I played both of the characters, you were like gross. You,
really?
Yeah, because I played you as like you did something. You took like a lizard tooth and you like stabbed it in some guy's throat or something. Jesus. Like you were just, because I was like, no, let's see what they have to. I don't remember exactly how it went, but I was like, I want no part of this. And you're like, fine, close your eyes. And then you like murdering this guy. So yeah, you were pretty brutal.
Wow, I'm brutal.
You never, and you never even knew it. I mean, jeez.
I guess not. Wow.
Comes out every now and then.
I'm a psycho. Yeah. Great.
Multiple personalities, maybe.
People are wondering what edition is the best to play.
That's a good question. I mean, that's a personal, like, it depends on what you're looking for, right? I mean, fifth edition for me, I'm loving right now. I grew up on the old stuff too, but fourth edition was very tactics oriented. I liked fourth edition, but it was more centered around tactical combat. At least that's what I glistened from it.
Yeah.
Three points. Yeah.
Like, it's completely. It's almost like if you were to take an MMO and translate it into a TRPG.
Yeah.
And some people loved it, and it's a very polarizing edition.
Yeah. Yeah, it didn't have the kind of same feel as 3.5, 3.0, and, you know, so it kind of took a lot of people by surprise.
Mm-hmm. I kind of feel like 5e in a way, and I'm slightly biased, just slightly, but 5e is a good mix of all of the editions in a way, where like 3.5 is a modded 3, which is a modded 1, and they took the best elements out of 3.5 and then also added the difficulty that you found in second edition. Mm. Which I really liked. I like that. And then they created diversity in it, which is, I think it makes it easier to consume for a lot of people who want to play it and have never played it before.
Mm. How long has Dungeons and Dragons been around for?
40 years at this point? Yeah. So there's been some additions.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, has there ever been a point, Eric, where we did something that you weren't expecting us to do and you had to kind of rework what you had in your mind?
Like,
we caught you off guard at any point?
You didn't catch me. Well, kind of, but it wasn't like an off guard thing. I thought it was really cool, and I mentioned this before, was the part where Fizgig the king sent you out, or not the king, his magistrate sent you out to deal with those ruffians in the woods.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And instead of killing them, you guys role played it out and said, hey, okay, how about we talk to the king and get you under contract, right? And I thought that was awesome, you know, because that was an instance where role playing completely changed the story. And I mean, so the way I look at the telling the story is I have certain key points that I know you need to get to, but you can kind of change everything from those in between those key points, and it can take the game in any direction you guys want to go in.
Cool. That was all Katie.
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
I was like, I don't want to kill these people.
Yeah.
I have kids.
Eric, what was your experience with transferring the Caves of Chaos over to 5th edition?
For me, the way I do converting is I really just take the story and then throw in the monsters that I want from the monster manual. So I mean, for me, that's where I get converting a story. It's just, or converting a module. I mean, really the bulk of what you need is the story, and then you can just slip whatever monsters you want that, you know, are relatively the same level as the characters. So
that's
kind of how I go about it.
Nice.
Yeah, it's translated really well.
Yeah.
It's cool.
Now, have you ever done a D&D adventure like in space, or sort of like a more futuristic role playing thing?
Yeah, and it's super fun. There used to be Spelljammer was an old D&D campaign setting where you were in where it was kind of sci-fi ish.
That's cool.
Yeah, it's super fun. So we might get there eventually. we'll roll into that. Yeah, see what choices. Because it was interesting, people were, you know, were asking like, "Oh, where's the story going to go?" And I'm like, "Really, it's kind of depending on what you guys do right now." So, it's kind of fun to see this kind of generate and become a whole new story.
Yeah, I think we got. Let's see here. Today is 22nd, so we've got next week and the week after, and then Katie and I are going to be gone for. We're gone for the 13th and the 20th as well, right?
Okay.
I think.
So we will be back after Christmas.
Then we're back on the 27th. And then Tuesday is actually my birthday, the 3rd.
What?
So.
What?
So we'll figure out something there.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
My birthday's on a Tuesday. That's lame.
Yeah, it's always sucky when you're like, oh, man.
Well, I think we get the 2nd off of work, too, to celebrate since the 1st is a Sunday. Oh, man. New Year's Eve is a Saturday this year. That could be dangerous.
Oh.
So we'll get the 2nd off.
We have fireworks if either of you want to come to Austin.
I invited Eric down, but not Alyssa.
I can't come.
I get it. I get it.
Keep your Seattle secret and we'll...
Here. Yeah, I no secrets in Seattle. I'm just saying.
You're secretless in Seattle.
Yeah, I'm secretless in Seattle.
That's more Efron. Go kill yourself. We watched Brooklyn Nine-Nine, and there was an episode last night where two characters were planning on getting married, and they're like, "We love not Christine." Christine is the lady that directed Twilight. I forget what the lady's name was, but she wrote like The Holiday and a bunch of like romantic comedies. And they kept making Nora Ephron references. And then at the end of the film, she's like, yeah, it's kind of like better than Sleepless in Seattle. And the character goes, that's Nora Ephron to go kill yourself. Really funny. Like, oh my gosh. Anyway.
Greatest ever 180 uses the hashtag and he says
Sorry about that.
The real reward is the journey, but how do you set preset treasures and their bonuses?
Mm. Oh, good question. On the fly? No. What I do is I kind of prepare ahead for situations and think about the characters, their levels, and what they might need. Like the good one was where Arcasynth said, remember in the creek episode where you were done with all the little guys in saying creek, and then you said, is there a bookshelf here? I'm like, actually, originally, no, there wasn't any bookshelf in the room. But I sat there and I'm like, oh, this could be kind of fun. And I said, yeah. And there was two books, and you know, one of them was a pit trap underneath, and the other one was the reward with the
ring, right?
With the ring in it. And I knew you guys needed some armor, so it's easy to, you know, think of, oh, okay, a plus one protection ring gives you plus one AC.
Yeah.
So that whole situation, that's another situation, Jack, where it was kind of like a caught off guard, but turned out to be a really cool little...
Yeah, it was fun little bit there.
Yeah, because was it Ruki that kind of dove and as the pit...
Yeah, she hit us, and then we grabbed the book as we were flying back. The other one.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's kind of how I figure out... I mean, there's... If you look in the Dungeon Master's Guide, there's a... level a table that tells you what your characters should have at each level based on like gold and magic items. Okay. And stuff, so that's useful for a DM to look at, so you can use that, but also to think ahead and think of what your characters might want or need or think is really cool, so stuff like that.
Cool.
Alyssa, do you want to answer that question about WotC? Or is that...
Oh, sure. Yeah, I loved working at WotC, actually.
So Alyssa was asked by White Knight, was it cool, as I imagine, working at Wizards of the Coast? Mm-hmm. Were there awesome dragon pictures all around the place? And does Chris Perkins transform into a bard to write the lore?
So Wizards of the Coast was amazing. I ended up just having a fantastic time. I met such wonderful people, talented people, working on really interesting projects that were constantly challenging. And I don't know, it was like, yeah, there's a lot of artwork between Magic and D&D, which is really sweet. And
are you kidding me? The front door is a giant, like, 15-foot dragon. It's awesome.
Yeah, you walk up to the fourth floor, which is where the lobby is, and there's just a huge dragon there. Her name's Mitzi. So, it's really cool. Working there is sweet. I miss it every day.
What do you do now?
I'm a freelance producer, so I'm working on a few different projects between board games and some film projects and stuff like that.
Cool.
Oh, yeah. Very cool.
Yeah.
I didn't know you did film stuff. That's pretty exciting.
Yeah, I try to stick more in the gaming, so the film stuff's related to gaming.
That's cool. But,
yeah.
Well, of Warcraft 2 confirmed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right?
Oh.
Half-Life 3 movie confirmed now. Just joking.
Yeah, no.
I didn't see one. I actually really wanted to see the World of Warcraft movie.
Just Warcraft, not World
of Warcraft. Sorry, Warcraft movie, because I don't know anything about it, and it looked pretty cool.
It was interesting, but the problem was, maybe not problem, but the thing was, they set it before World of Warcraft.
Right.
So it's like Warcraft 1 and 2, or maybe even a little 3, leading into what became the World of Warcraft. So like, if all you played is World of Warcraft, you recognize characters, but like they're super young, or they're like older characters, or like characters are like, oh, this character's been dead for a long time. Mm. So it's like, oh yeah, that, like, oh, that's you know, the wizard. And it's like, oh wait, that, no, he's bad now. And then yeah, so it's kind of neat to see the origin if you really, really know the backstory of Warcraft.
Yeah.
But if you've only been, if you like, you know Thrall, it's like, oh cool, I know Thrall, and you see Thrall, but as a baby. And it's like, I don't see Thrall, or you know, you see Doomhammer, but
yeah.
Anyway, I mean, it was interesting. The CGI was pretty cool, but it felt that like the knights and stuff had these. I mean, they looked like just ridiculous because they had like giant shoulder pads, like the game.
Right.
I was like, real life, it like didn't really translate so well. It was like, that looks kind of dorky, actually.
Yeah.
Because you know that so many people work their butts off.
Oh yeah.
To produce that or to create that movie, and it's like just did not land as well as they wanted it to. Yeah. And that really bums me out.
But it was like Dark Portal and stuff, and it was there was some cool stuff to it, but it was a lot. Like, it was a very, very dense movie with a lot of lore, and it's like, if you like, I think they needed to dumb it down a little bit more. Like, it was a little too in depth, and like dumb it down, kind of like what Marvel movies do, where it's like there's decades of comics you can go and pull research and get information about these characters, or we're going to kind of simplify it where if you know that stuff, it's like, oh, I recognize right. that.
Yeah, I think particularly Marvel does a good job because they still drop those references and Easter eggs that are subtle for people who don't know them, but for people who do, they feel like they've almost
it's like a reward.
They've been rewarded for it, which is nice, you know.
Speaking of good universes, I know we're deviating a little bit. Oh. Fantastic Beasts was phenomenal.
I haven't seen it yet, and I want to go see it.
I'm seeing it on Thanksgiving.
It's it's just really, really good. And it's like one of the first films in a long time that I can say the trailer doesn't spoil anything.
Really?
It's actually really, really nice that you go into it and you're like, okay, I know what to expect in terms of like what this movie is about. Like, you know, it's this guy who's coming to New York, he's British, like, you know, he's never been there before, or he's hiding animals, that you don't, like, that's not the movie, you know, and so it's really awesome that we got to go in there, and we were surprised. Like, we didn't watch a trailer that was just basically a 1.5 minute version of the movie, you know. It was really, really surprising. There was a lot of, it was just so well done. It was just, it's hard to elaborate on it. And I don't want to in case it sets any pretense for you, or spoils anything, but, it just was a really great movie that was like kind of dumbed down in a way that was very easy to absorb and understand, but was also like powerful enough where it kind of, it made you really care about it and want to know more. So,
that's
and
awesome.
I have people who've never seen Harry Potter movies who really enjoyed it. So it was like their introduction kind of to that world. But it is definitely kind of a reward, I guess, for that's a cat, but for the generation that grew up with Harry Potter, because it definitely is more of an adult film.
Yeah, and it's also interesting too because it's the first Harry Potter universe story that we knew nothing about going into, like literally nothing.
That's
like
a book to refer.
Yeah, every other one has a book. Even the play has a book, but it's like now it's like, okay, you're going in completely blind. And I like that a lot. Uday's here. He's saying hello.
They did release the screenplay of it though.
Did they really?
They did. They released it just today, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Which is cool. I mean, it's in that format, but I think that makes it really interesting that it's in that format.
Yeah, especially if there are bits in it that they chopped out of the movie.
Yeah.
Maybe
we'll grab that at the airport tomorrow.
Yeah, right.
I think that'd be really fun. The play was I'm less thrilled with, but I tell myself that she didn't write it. Like she kind of wrote it but didn't really write it. Like it's a play, so it needs to be in a different format, so she did have to rely on the playwriters to do the two dudes that did it with her, Steve something, I don't know, but anyway,
right.
But the film, there are five movies of this, you know, like of this part, and she said it starts in 1925 or 26 and it ends in the 1940s, like late 1940s,
which could be interesting because it's gonna be World War II during it, so I wonder how that's gonna mix in with everything. So
that's crazy. We're vampires, and if you're a vampire that sucked, but if you're a Nazi vampire that was really bad. Have you seen What We Do in the Shadows?
Oh yeah.
Absolutely see that movie. Cage says, how does it change that you set aside a day of the week to play D&D? Also, did you like that chat made Creek a stream meme?
Yeah, it's great.
It's kind of cool. It's nice to be like, all right, Tuesdays is D&D days. It's good.
Consistent.
And so it's kind of
I think as an adult planning, like having a schedule is good.
Yeah.
Yeah. I look forward to Tuesdays. I just love, you know, I love D&D, and getting to play is always a highlight of the week. So
I feel like it hits Wednesday and Eric's like, is it Tuesday yet?
Yeah, every Wednesday I say that in group chat. I'm like, is it Tuesday again? I want to play.
And I feel like the creek thing was really funny. We were playing Jack in the Box games, and want someone's name
Jackbox in it.
Jackbox games. And out of nowhere, excuse me, this is just recent, like a few days ago, someone had named their character Creek, and I just thought that was like Creek, and I was like, oh, that's cool that you kind of brought that from Dungeons and Dragons stream. So
that's awesome.
Really cool. That was a funny. That whole situation was hilarious.
Yeah, it was pretty goofy.
It worked out really well.
It was fun times.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, actually, let's get back to that question. What have been your favorite moments in the campaign?
I'm on a horse. No.
Hey, you got a donkey.
Yeah. I do have a donkey. I'm yet to like establish a proper relationship with her, but
I like one of our earlier sessions before Liz was there when we had Thaddeus with us, and he kept blowing up trees around us. Like, there was one time he couldn't throw anything over like a 3.
Yeah, he kept
missing all of his spells.
Yeah, and,
I think I really liked when actually because Thaddeus would really put the accents on, and I really enjoyed that. But the part where he was accepting money from the magistrate and was like, okay, yeah, so it'd be like 50 each.
Yeah.
And he told us that it was like we get 10 gold or something, we couldn't do anything about it because we technically shouldn't have known.
Yeah.
And I thought that was a really interesting introduction into like sort of, you know, excuse me, you weren't a part of that conversation, so you don't know that that's what he's doing.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly.
That was good. When we found Rick the first time tied up to the thing and we were killing stuff around him was pretty great.
And we're like,
that was,
yeah.
That was funny.
That's so, yeah. I also really liked when we were in that house and we were being attacked by the, was it a mountain lion?
Oh, the cat? Oh,
the lion?
Yeah.
Yep. And like, we just kept rolling the worst.
Yeah.
The worst rolls.
And we kept like, talking to it, and then it would get free and then it would talk. It's like, God damn it.
Yeah, I forgot about that. And then wasn't he, because he was being dragged with the mountain lion, and he would just keep calling out to it a while, right?
We're like, okay, if we take this gag out of your mouth, you're gonna be good, right? He's like, okay, and then he immediately is yelling, he's like, God.
I think Ruki's introduction was really fun.
That was hilarious.
Oh yeah, that was awesome. We were all trying to one up each other.
Uh-huh. Yeah, just jumping onto the table.
Yeah. Oh, I think it's just been. I liked Scott's. I liked. Baracus's backstory about the knife in between his rib or whatever.
Yeah, it was good.
Specific and funny.
That was good. What do you guys think of Xavier so far? He's not here. We can talk about him.
Oh yeah.
Oh, he's a badass.
Yeah.
I think he has an agenda. I don't know yet.
Yeah.
He's so nice, and he keeps like refusing the gold, and he's like, no, I'm so noble, and I'm gonna get, what's the thing called, where you get it's not experience,
inspiration.
Yeah.
He's like, I'm gonna do this really great thing, can I have a reward for that? And so it's like, you're up to something.
Right.
Sneaky.
No, I don't know, I'm interested to see like what his whole deal is with the family heirloom. And but I really like him. I think he's fun.
Yeah.
And I kind of do think of him as Eugene. That's his real name. I keep using his real name.
Flynn Rider
from Tangled. Like, it kind of that's sort of like that air of like aloofness, but like also I'm super noble, but also I could like ditch you in a second.
His moral compass is
to you.
What was that, Alyssa?
Oh, I was saying his moral compass is interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, I can't quite figure it out, and I'm really interested to see where it goes, because I think it adds another layer to our group. But I don't know if he is going, if Xavier is going to betray us.
Yeah.
Well, he's got his heirloom now, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Who knows what that thing does.
But I don't know what else he wants. Like, I feel like he's not just with our group just because... you know, that, you know, we're adventuring and he wants to stick with us, or like, you know, if he actually has some sort of other intention.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Remember, anyone in chat right now, if you have any questions about our D&D sessions, feel free to ask. We're just going over stuff, recapping everything we've done so far. How many sessions have we done? Does anyone
have a count? Eight so far. Oh, wow. Not nine plus the care if you count the character creation one.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
It feels like more than that.
Yeah. Well, they're long sessions.
Yeah. Actually, somebody asked in your chat what was the longest session you ever played.
Oh yeah.
And I don't know, Alyssa, what do you got?
I think the longest I ever played was 8 hours.
Wow.
That's cool.
Maybe eight. I don't know. I feel like it's somewhere around there.
That was, I think that was mine too, because at Gen Con, no, mine was like 12 hours, but it was at Gen Con.
Wow.
And it was a midnight game. The game started at midnight, and it was a Ravenloft second edition game. Ravenloft is a campaign setting for D&D that's all about vampires, werewolves. You're in, it's a phenomenal, it's my favorite campaign setting.
Yeah, the gothic horror theme.
Yeah, the whole gothic horror. So we played at night in a dark room with candles lit at Gen Con, and we played from midnight till noon. Wow. So the sun came up. Yeah, it was cool.
That's awesome. Yeah, I would have to say, like, on average, most of mine end up being around 4 hours.
Yeah.
4 or 5 hours or so.
I think the longest session we played here was like 3 hours or 3.5 hours.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that was it for us.
Yeah.
Remember that time we were playing that game at
Celebrity?
The fire alarm went off.
Paxies.
Yeah, that was the whole.
Oh, were you guys in the West End lobby during that?
Yeah.
Oh, me too. Yeah.
We were playing this game and I was so into it and I'd never played it before and I was so excited about it. It was so like simple but like really fun and challenging.
Yeah.
And I was like 2 a.m. and then the fire alarm went off.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Like what, 500 people or whatever? Yeah.
And no one would tell us anything. We're like, do we go outside or do
we just stayed in the lobby. We just sat there.
Did you?
Yeah. No one left. Or like maybe
they made us evacuate upstairs. We were upstairs.
Yeah, that's what it was.
Come downstairs.
Okay.
That's what it was.
Yeah, I just sat in the lobby and everyone kind of stared at each other wondering what to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no one said anything. And we're like, okay.
Okay, we're going to just chill.
I didn't even know you then, but we were in the same hotel. Yep. So.
Small world.
Hey, speaking of moral compass, what was Arcason doing with the potion? We all want to know.
I was weighing up us needing it. Listen, I haven't forgotten that we're trying to solidify this treaty with the people in the woods. Like I haven't forgotten that's like one of the reasons that I'm here doing, or like that Hyacinth is doing this quest, is to get this all back to Fizzgig. So that we can, you know, get this treaty into law, essentially. Mm-hmm. So I was thinking, well, this is an old woman, and it sucks that she's been here, and I really want her to, if she's going to die, at least see the sun before she, you know, passes. But I was like, this is also a health potion, and I have a lot of other lives potentially on the line. Like if we die or something happens to us, then everyone in the woods, like what happens to them, we don't know. So I was essentially weighing up this elderly woman with the people and their families in the woods. Like which one is more important or which one is more kind of pressing? Not right. That one life is more important than another, but kind of weighing up, is this health potion going to save us and enable us to create this treaty? Or if I give this health potion to this woman, is she going to, is she just going to die anyway? And is that like a waste? Will we need it later on? And I'm acutely aware that it was, Rookie's health potion, but still I was like, I don't know, but. Yeah. I mean, she turned out okay. Also, I was thinking, this is, you know, this is the Middle Ages? Is that what it's like? We're in kind of an old fantasy world. It's like, how did she even make it to 70? Like, that's how I, like, how did she get to be an old woman? I don't know. I don't know. I was thinking,
of all the times, like, that's such like a thing that I would do. I thought you'd be like, here, like give me, here's everything. Take our cloak, take some money, like, go, be safe.
Right. Yeah. We were all perplexed. We were all perplexed.
Yeah. You and Xavier were like, well, I don't know. And we're like, just feed her. Yeah, it was like complete role reversal. It was just interesting.
It was very odd.
Yeah, it was great.
That's probably one of the times that I have really gotten into kind of like character, I guess.
Yeah.
Like, what would she be as a diplomat? Like, what would she be thinking? And it's definitely weighing up between, are we going to need this later to ensure the safety and survival of this group of people, this like tribe of sorts, or do we sacrifice one health potion to give to an old woman who's got like 1 year left, you know, like who's maybe so wounded from this whole experience that, you know, maybe she's crazy now, maybe, like, you know, maybe she doesn't want to live in this world now that she's being like tortured. I don't know, like, I thought too much about it, I guess.
I guess it was like kind of in that instant that I realized that, like, for Ruki, even though she's kind of morally ambiguous with being chaotic good, I mean, like, obviously she's going to do whatever it takes to fulfill, I guess, her oath or something that, like, she's obviously a good character, so she's going to do whatever she has to do in order to do the right thing. But that can also be not great, like, torturing someone for answers to get something good accomplished, I guess, is fine in her eyes. And I just realized that, like I think during that situation, it was like, she's going to just take action whenever anything's questioned, if it's like the good thing to do in her eyes, I guess.
Like a gut instinct.
Exactly. Which I guess was something that I just never, you know how like one of the things that I like during D&D is that you get to know your character as you play your character. And I guess that was just kind of like a new trait that I kind of realized about Ruki during it. I don't know.
I think that's a really fun thing to or not even, it's sort of like a transformative thing, I guess. Like, and I think it happens a lot with, I haven't had a whole lot of experience doing long narratives with acting, but I think that that's, again, something that you can kind of relate that to, is making decisions from what you've established as the person that is that character, and kind of like embodying that and making gut decisions and then learning about it, you know, later on, going, okay, like, now that I've kind of embodied that and I've made that decision, that teaches me more about that character and about like, you know, the way that they react to things. So it's pretty cool.
Cage in our chat says, does your campaign have permadeath, or do you restart another character?
I don't know what that means.
So, say you guys died, is the character totally dead forever, or and you're out of the game, do you get to roll another character and come back into the story? If somebody died, we have them roll another character, or it depends on where we're at the story. Your group might go and try to raise you from the dead, or go find your soul in you know, wherever it may be, and then, you know, that's a cool feature that you can add to the narrative of the story. If somebody dies, there's a lot of cool ways to get them back from the dead.
That's cool.
So, say
for example someone dies and you reroll the new character, would you reroll at level 3 or whatever level we're at now, or would it be something you just have to start over and kind of work your way up?
I personally would have you at the current group level.
Okay.
That's pretty standard.
Keep everything fair.
Yeah. But for a lot of the times, your traveling companions might like you enough to try and raise you from the dead at first.
Might.
Xavier's still up.
At any point, I mean, like, how high of a level have you gotten a character up to before?
I was like 22.
Wow.
Yeah.
I mean, are you not like super powered by that point?
Yeah,
I mean,
it's ridiculous.
You are, but then you fight things that are extremely powerful as well. So you kind of scale it as well.
Okay.
It's like a battle of the gods.
I had a campaign on Friday where my level 4 players ended up fighting 35 different creatures, but they were all fairly low level, and they were just guards. So, which really, you know, they have high ACs, but they're pretty weak.
Yeah.
So, stuff like that happens.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah.
Man. Yeah, it's there's a lot of different ways to go about it. What the heck?
Can one person play two characters?
Yeah, if you wanted to. If the GM lets you, or DM lets you, yeah. But usually, I mean, it's a lot to be doing all at once, so usually you play one character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that I guess that would be tricky. It's easy when they're attached.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I kind of like, I'm like, one day Hyacinth and Archimedes will be separate beings again, and then I'm like, oh, would it be funny to like separate us and then attach us to someone else?
Yeah, that's funny. So that's wait, funny. What do you guys think of Fizgig, and what do you think he's going to do with the orb?
I don't know.
I didn't know what a scrying orb was until last week.
Yeah.
And I feel like I should have asked that question, but just kind of like didn't question it.
Yeah.
But now that I know what a scrying orb is, I thought he just wanted it so the cleric didn't have it, but if he's going to use it, then I don't know. Like, it's different now. What were you going to say? Sorry, Jack.
I forget what I was going to say.
Sorry.
And also, Hyacinth, you have that little snippet of information that the old woman whispered in your ear, so you might have a different, even
it's
a... Like,
it's my orb.
Yeah.
Nobody touches but me.
You're going to grab it.
I don't know, because it's like you're not supposed to touch it. Like, it's like the one piece of advice was don't touch it, but then that woman's like, touch it, do it, put your finger on it. So now I don't know. I have to figure it out.
Be interesting. We'll see what happens. Ghostbud says, how have you dealt with players metagaming? Do you like it to be notes passed, or just accepting people having the disconnect with player and character knowledge?
A little bit of both. Notes passed can be really fun. At some home games, I'd have players take me aside and bring me out of the room to say they want to do something. But also, you know, sometimes it's fun. I like hearing chatter around the table from the group, like planning and saying, oh, if we do this, this could happen. So a little bit of metagaming is fine, I think. I'm not always opposed to it. So it's really getting, you know, where what you really like, I guess, because I like the players to kind of develop a strategy, even though they really can't talk to each other that much in game. I think it just enhances the story. And the characters can, or the players can feel like they're really coming up with these cool ideas.
Yeah, I mean, that was like when we were in the hallway that one time where it's like, okay, if we'll attack over here, then you come from behind. Like, that could be a huge thing, which in an actual scenario, there's no chance in hell that would happen.
Right. Like each turn that you take is supposed to be 6 seconds, right? So you couldn't sit there and have this long conversation of, oh, if we do this and that and that. But I think it's kind of cool, especially streaming. And, you know, to have these conversations of, oh, all these cool things we could do.
Make it a bit more descriptive.
Yeah, exactly.
I feel like also it helps us bond as, like, friends, too, is to kind of just and learn more about each other.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I think that's been really fun and important. I feel like I had a question. I forget what it was. Oh, do unicorns exist in Dungeons & Dragons?
I have seen a unicorn played on a stage. So, yes, I'm going with yes. You can find a unicorn somewhere.
Well, so there's this interesting thing. As a sorcerer, sometimes you have wild magic because magic is innate within you, right? And you just are learning how to harness it in a way. But sometimes you have this wild magic that just sometimes happens, and it's up to the DM's discretion kind of when it does. And my friend who's extremely into unicorns, like he loves unicorns, like wears Christmas sweaters with unicorns on it and stuff like that. Like it's crazy. He rolled on the wild magic chart and actually summoned a unicorn. Like it's a thing and it happens and it's amazing.
I feel like that was the universe saying, we got you.
Yeah.
Yes. Like we were all blown away because you look at the chart, he rolled it exactly.
That's funny.
Phenomenal.
That's great.
Is it like a Cabin in the Woods? Like a unicorn just like runs and stabs someone in the heart?
Basically, yeah. Yeah. Like you get one wish, but like a monkey paw wish. So.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Oh,
man.
Oh, maybe the donkey will turn into a unicorn.
Oh.
I don't know. I kind of want a donkey more. We went to a wedding this last Saturday, and they had two mini donkeys, a burro, I don't know how you pronounce it, a horse, and two pygmy goats. And there was a donkey there that looked exactly like the kind of donkey that I wanted. And I wanted nothing more than to be friends with it. And so I kept feeding it and like trying to pet it, and it just didn't want me to pet it. And then so I left, and I came back like an hour later. And I was just like, I was just kind of like really just like asking the universe, going like, I just want to be friends with this donkey. And then I put my hand in and he let me pet him, or she let me pet him.
And you called her Raya, and like the whole thing just came together.
Like fireworks, yeah. And everything stopped.
Yeah, it comes in.
And I was like so excited because the donkey let me pet it. And I was like, aw, this is meant to be. I'm meant to have a donkey.
That's amazing.
That's one awesome. Day,
Jack. That's phenomenal.
One day I will have a donkey.
One day. Good luck with that. You know how it goes.
Yeah, right.
You and your donkey.
Nine. You get to have cats.
So how far in advance have you planned out our campaign, Eric? Like, I mean, really the Caves of Chaos is kind of like what we were going for, but like, is there more beyond that?
Or
is
yeah.
All right, you wrapped up that and then we move on to a different segment. I don't know how it works.
Yeah. So the way I'm doing it right now, it all depends on a couple choices you make, which direction we're going to go. So I've planned a couple sessions ahead, but not too far ahead, because it's all going to depend on the choices that you make and the things you do that are going to take us in a one of a couple different directions.
That's cool. Exciting.
Yeah, so it's going to be cool to see what you do, how you do it, what you role play, and you know, and what everything that goes on, because that's really going to dictate where the story goes. Like I said, it's really just like a giant choose your own adventure book.
So you were saying that there are veins in the wall?
Yeah.
They're
running through the wall, through the stone.
So I guess that implies that the Caves of Chaos are sentient.
Ish.
Oh man, I'm so excited.
Yeah.
Can we have a Caves of Chaos pet?
Oh yeah, a familiar.
The cave follows us around.
That's great. Maybe. Maybe. Maybe Helob will get like a couple new rings around him or something.
Kosvara says, is Dungeons & Dragons your favorite RPG setting, or are you a fan of a different rule set?
I don't know what that means.
Like
either.
other
yeah. Like Hackmaster or there's the Star Wars one as well.
Yeah. For me, Dungeons & Dragons is my favorite RPG setting. It's just because it was the one I grew up on. It was my first RPG, and I just absolutely love D&D, but there are other games that are really great too, like the Star Wars RPGs are awesome. Dungeon World, if you guys haven't checked out Dungeon World, it's super great. It's a great narrative based RPG that I really like too. So,
I feel like this is the first kind of RPG in gaming that I really kind of devoted a lot of time to is Fable. And I feel like that was Fable 2, I think. And I just remember I still am like riddled with guilt, kind of, because at the end you get like three choices. One of them is like to get tons of money, to resurrect everyone that died, or to ensure that your sister isn't dead. And I chose that. I didn't want my sister, because when you resurrected everyone, it didn't include your sister. And so I chose my sister. And then the big woman with the like ripped woman with the not axe, like the hammer, was like, I can't believe that you decided that. All the families that have lost people and you just let them be dead, all just to serve your own purpose. And she just like left. And I was like, yeah. Oh man, I feel terrible. I have to play it all over again.
But Fable was a great game, right?
It was really good. Oh, sorry. It was really, really good. I really enjoyed it. And I felt like I had a lot of, I felt like I had a lot of control, and it was a very open world that was kind of magical, like not Grand Theft Auto, you know, which I enjoy playing Grand Theft Auto because I like driving around and it is very open world, but I guess it's kind of more magical and whimsical, but also like adult, if that makes any sense. I don't know. I just thought it was really cool. Yeah. I could never organize my money though, and I was always fat. Like, it didn't matter how much celery I ate, I was just always overweight. And I just didn't matter.
Nice. So.
Excuse me. Uday, are you sleepy?
This is Uday. He hasn't been feeling great lately, so.
Oh.
Hola.
He's an old man.
Yeah. Murphy's getting there, and I'm scared of it. He's at 10 years old now.
Aww. Yeah. My sister's dog had to be put down recently, and it's like, I've known him forever. So.
So scared.
You want this in your face? I got this to you. You do to him all the time.
But he's sleepy.
What? He's always sleepy now.
Look how sleepy he is.
Aww.
Aww. Face.
Look at that face.
Is Murphy your dog or your cat?
My dog here. Murphy, come here. This is Murphy.
Aww.
Watch this. This is his thing.
He just hangs out.
Just hangs out.
Part koala.
Yeah, he's an Australian shepherd, so I guess, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you're not far off.
Yeah.
Aww.
It's a long-haired art. Emma, our dog, she's Australian Shepherd mixed with
something.
God knows what.
Yeah.
She's a pound pup. She's right there.
She has shorter hair, but she has so much of it.
Yeah.
So frustrating because it's everywhere all the time.
But everyone has their pets.
Yeah. Hey, you got a spider.
Aw.
Yeah. Aww. Get on my level.
So cute.
Oh, I found out today that... that Jack's Nan's cousin,
your grandmother.
Yeah, your grandmother's cousin contributed or like helped write Conan the Barbarian, which I thought was pretty. Is he was best friends with not Howard. His name was Howard. Whoever wrote Conan the Barbarian, which I forget what his name is. He's just a fantasy writer. He was best friends with him, and they exchanged letters all the time, and that's how he wrote, that's how the author wrote Conan the Barbarian. And so I was just researching his family history here in Austin, and then through that found his Nan's cousin, and then found a bunch of books that he'd written, and then that he was best friends with the guy. So I was like, whoa. Crazy world. I have a hair on my nose, and it's excruciating.
Oh, look, Murphy.
No.
This is what he does. Like, I walk into the house, jumps on me like Dino from the Flintstones.
Aww,
yeah. That's amazing. I used to have a puppy growing up. He'd always smile when you walk in the door.
Aww.
He had a little. It was pretty great. Dogs are the best.
Yep.
Yeah, Emma's cute and she can be annoying at times. Like, whenever we have friends come over, it's one of two things. Either A, she freaks out and doesn't want to go near them, which is really weird. Mostly guys. Or B, she loses her goddamn mind and like like her heart starts pounding and she's running around jumping up and down. It's like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
And so like there is no chill. I was like, with us, she's like, oh hey, I'm happy you're home. But like our friends come over and she just goes nuts. So I assume she thinks when we leave the front door we're dead.
Yeah.
So she's just very happy that we're not dead.
Yeah.
Like, I haven't seen you in 3 weeks. I thought you were dead. And so she really goes crazier for people she doesn't see often.
Yeah.
I guess that makes sense.
So. Oh, pets.
She's a dog. Emma, are you a dog?
Emma.
Are you a dog?
Oh, she's coming around. So, good times. Well, but we'll be back next Tuesday, right?
Play more? Absolutely. And we Yes, Tuesday. 7 o'clock. Same bat time, same bat channel.
7 PST.
Yes. What time for you guys? That's 9?
That's 9 for us, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Very cool.
All right.
All right. Well, let's wrap it up, and we'll circle around next week.
That sounds good. Yeah. And we're going to hang out on our channel, probably play a little bit of video games.
Sweet.
And so.
Awesome.
I'm going to go play some Diablo, and then I'm going to go play some Civ.
Nice. You should play some Skyrim.
Some Skyrim?
Yeah.
I did today. Oh, it's so much fun. I have the coolest lizard man.
I voted when you did that quiz. You're like, what should I play? I was like, Skyrim.
Yeah. Did you? Thank you. Mm-hmm. Or else I would have been crying today playing Dark Souls. So I appreciate that.
Nice.
Well, I'm glad that it was fun.
Yeah, it's great. It's awesome.
Excellent.
Hey, guys, before we leave, mute your audio for a second. I got to ask you guys a question before.
So wait, hang on 1 second.
We'll be right back.
Oh, hang on 1 second. Yeah. You go to video.
All right. Thanks for watching, guys. We'll see you next week at 7 o'clock. Bye.
Yeah. Bye, guys.